eyes haven't seen, and ears haven't heard the kind of blessings, the kind of blessings that's about to fall on me. Woo. 'Cause victory is here. Kick defeat out the door. God's doing a new thing. Yeah. Get ready for.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody, and welcome to the Breaking Room. I'm Dr. Zina Pierre. We thank and praise God for your presence here today. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Today is going to be an awesome show. We have a great man of God from the state of Louisiana. I don't even want to call his name yet. I just want you to see for yourself how the ministry that he carries in his belly, God is using him across the globe.
I don't know if that's God, but I'm just going to obey. Turns around, go to 7th Street, and then the Spirit told him to stop 3 blocks ahead and pull over on the curve. Matthew said, nah, partner, not in this neighborhood. They sling guns, they sling drugs. I can't sit down in this neighborhood. But he did what the Spirit and voice told him to do. Then the Spirit went far. Mother Nelson told Matthew, get out of his car, knock on the address 1913, and give the man the milk. Matthew said, nah, I ain't rolling up on nobody's door, but I do what you told me to do. Knocked on the door, and they had a man come out of the room, and he was rage, and he was abrupt, and he opens the door, holler at Matthew, what are you doing at my house? Matthew said, man, I don't even know, but take this milk. The man grabbed the gallon of milk, runs back into the house, go into the room, then his wife come out crying. She said,
well, praise the Lord, and we thank God for such a phenomenal and humble man of God that's with us today, none other than Dr. Jonathan Everett, all the way from Louisiana. Yeah, pastor 2 phenomenal churches in 2 locations and 2 cities in the state of Louisiana.
I'm getting happy as you talk.
Oh, my God, the Lord is good, and he's kind to you. Yeah, and so Rock of Ages Baptist Church in New Orleans,
yes,
right?
Ma'am. Yes,
ma'am. And then Greater Philadelphia Baptist Church in
Zachary, Louisiana.
Well, welcome to the Breaking Room and to the Word Network. We thank God for your presence here today.
Well, we say thank you, first of all, so very much for this opportunity to come and to share what the Lord is doing down in the bottom, wow, the real bottom of the booth. I'm extremely excited today. Just sitting on this stage is a true testament to what the Lord can do in and through your life.
Amen.
To be able to pastor both churches, and while you was talking, every now and then when you're in what we call the minutiae of ministry, you don't see all that you're doing.
Yes.
And so I'm sitting back listening to you talk, and I'm like, oh, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes,
you
know? It's a tall order, but it works.
It's work.
Yeah, it's work. Well, you know, your good friend, Pastor Mike Wingard, said, you know, you got to get my boy on your show. And so, you know, so whatever kind. Mike says, I do, of course, because I love he and his wife, Phyllis. Yeah. And, you know, you've been to the Temple of Praise, and oh my God, you just blow the place up. Yeah. And you have been around for a long time, for as long, young as you look, you've been in the trenches for a minute.
Yeah.
Tell me a bit about your ministry.
Well, we've been preaching for 20 years.
Wow.
Born and raised in New Orleans, Louisiana. And as I revert back to what we were saying earlier, that just me sitting on this stage is a testament of where the Lord will bring you from.
Hallelujah.
I grew up in the projects that they call the Fisher Housing Developments. My mother have 12 kids.
Wow.
And none of us dead or sick or none of those things, but we're healthy.
Hallelujah.
The 7th child. That's significant, right?
Yes, it is.
So it's just been a testament of continue to grow our ministry in New Orleans, Louisiana. It's founded on prayer. That's
Amen.
What we do.
Amen.
That's all we do. It's a younger, millennial, vibrant type atmosphere. Greater Philadelphia, wonderful church as well. In the Zachary community, Cheneyville community, which is a very awesome environment. to raise your kids and your family. And once again, founded on prayer, consistently praying and calling on the name of God. So there's various things in which we are doing at both ministries. We do these 5 a.m. prayer services, and people come from all over our city, outside of our city, and they pack the house out to pray and call on God at 5 a.m.
Wow.
So that's another story as to how we got there to prayer. I can keep on going as it relates to when I stayed in the state of Maryland, and I was doing ministry, full-time ministry. When I left the city of New Orleans in 2005, those preacher pastors taught me how to preach. They didn't tell me the significance of praying, and they didn't teach me the art of administration. When I arrived in Maryland, it was a different culture, a different breed of what we call ministry.
Yes.
They didn't teach me those mechanics. When I got there, I was so involved in doing the work of the church that in some instances, I forgot about the God of the work. And so I was morning to midnight, 6 a.m. to 1 in the morning doing ministry. I mean everything from administrating the school, before and after care, disciplinary. I was every day at the church, getting on the roof 3 o'clock in the morning and making sure this worked and going to class. Oh, it was a lot. But I wasn't praying.
Wow.
And I found myself just doing ministry, preaching without feeling what I was saying. I was praying every now and then, and I struggled with that for 5 years.
Wow.
And so after that, before I left the state of Maryland, the Lord paid me a good old visit and really awakened something in me and really taught me and really had a powwow with me and taught me about the effectiveness of prayer, that I couldn't really be effective in this work without consistently praying to the Lord. And so it has been a part of who I am today.
So
our prayer line, our virtual prayer line every single morning. I pray by myself.
Amen.
You know, it's a part of everything that I do now because I understand that it is the hinges in which I stand.
That's it. Prayer is a, you know, people think that prayer is a religion. It's not. It's a lifestyle.
It's a lifestyle.
I remember being in Nigeria and at a conference and the Dalai Lama was the keynote speaker.
Wow.
And we were afterward we all had brunch together because the conference was held by some friends whom I regard as family in Nigeria.
Yeah.
And so the Dalai Lama and I were talking and I had, you know, my thought of what Buddhism meant and I'll never forget him saying to me, Zina, Buddhism is not a religion. It's
a
lifestyle.
It's a lifestyle, yeah.
And it's likewise with prayer. We put our clothes on every day.
That's right.
And we get our way, you know, on to work or whatever we do. And it's the same thing. You've got to put prayer in your life in order to orchestrate your life.
That's true. That's true.
Because without it.
You know, I was upset with the church at one particular time coming up in ministry, when the church was in an uproar about our country taking prayer out of school. And coming up as a young preacher, I was really angry, not necessarily because they took prayer out of school. It was because I said, now they fussing about them taking prayer out of school. When if you look at it, seems like we took prayer out of church. All of our prayer services at that time was empty.
Yes.
Nobody was coming to prayer. Nobody was meeting us at the church to just pray. And so I was kind of mad and I said, wow, why are they complaining about that? And we're not doing what we're supposed to do at home in the church.
That is so true. Yes.
But I feel something is happening around our country.
There's a shift.
There's a shift.
Yes,
I feel it that you have more concentration on prayer. Because the Bible did declare that this shall be the house of prayer.
Yes.
And that this younger generation, I heard you mention one time that this younger generation, this millennial generation is hungry and necessarily so. And I truly believe not only that our strategies and not only our pretty churches, but powerless churches.
That's it.
Not only our these things in which we're doing to cultivate this culture of church.
Yeah.
I truly believe we have a generation rising up that's really putting prayer back as their main priority.
Yes, yes.
I see it all over the country. Various states people are doing these prayer meetings, mm-hmm. just prayer.
Yeah.
And it's really doing something, mm-hmm. to our country, mm-hmm. As it relates to the church.
That's
as it relates
right.
to the church.
You know, every morning, the breaking room, we come together, as you said, yeah. every morning at 7 a.m. Eastern time to pray.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we pray for 30 minutes. And then on Thursday nights, we come and we do a virtual Bible study.
Wow.
Where
wow.
I teach it myself.
Wow. Amazing.
Webinars, teaching on the power of prayer. It's so important because... you've got to understand the legalities in it,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
and how it operates. And Jesus taught us, he said, that kingdom come, that will be
yeah.
done on earth
yeah.
as
yeah.
it is in heaven.
That's it.
So that tells me that if that kingdom come, we must pull it down.
That's right. That's
and we
right.
pull it down with
That's
our
right.
prayer.
With
that
our
kingdom
prayer.
Come,
yeah. Yeah.
that will be done on earth as it is
in heaven.
Heaven. So we all, it tells you
yeah.
pretty much that there's something already stirring up
there. That's it.
That's already been established in the spiritual.
That's it.
And we just need to know how to pull it down in the natural.
Yeah. You know, I was hearing you talking about that. I had a member probably about a month or two ago matter of fact, we're talking about Pastor Mike Wingard. Me and him were sitting down eating some gumbo.
You made it?
And, no. We were eating some gumbo, and I got a phone call, and one of my members, she fell off a ladder, and they rushed her to the hospital. The mother of my church called and said that the doctor said that there's nothing else can be done but pray.
Mm.
That's what the doctor said. And so being who I am, I told Pastor Mike, I said, listen, this gumbo tastes good, but I got to go.
Amen.
And so
prayer
me and him,
demand.
Yeah, me and him jumped in a car. We rushed over to the hospital. I walked into the hospital and her brain was fractured. Her skull
Jesus.
Was fractured. Her socket was swollen. Mm-hmm. She was bleeding out of various parts of her brain. She was definitely unconscious. And so I walked in and the doctor told me, he said, Pastor, the only thing you can do but pray. And I responded to him, that's all I need.
That's it.
And so I walked into her room, just me and her, and I walked boldly in prayer and called on the name
God.
Of God.
Yes, Lord.
And I commanded certain things to happen.
Shandabasiya.
When I left mm-hmm. out of that room, the Lord had already told me she's going to be okay.
Hallelujah.
So what I did after that, I went into the emergency room. And you had all these people in the emergency room. And the mother of my church, I said, Mother, it's okay. She's going to be all right. I don't care what they say.
Yeah.
I know what God just told
yes,
me.
Yes, yes.
And so what I did was, because prayer, you have to walk in a sense of boldness.
Yes.
And so what I did, I called everybody in the emergency room and told them, I said, all y'all get in a circle.
Whew.
That same anointing that was operating in that room, it's the same anointing can fall on any and each disease
Hallelujah.
That is in this emergency room right now. That member is back at our church.
We give the Lord praise.
Walking in, and I see the Lord healing her through a process.
Yes.
And she told me before I was on my way, he said, Pastor, pray that my hearing come back. I said, that's going
to
come back
God.
Too.
Glory
the Lord
to
has
God.
Something for you. So that boldness in prayer and all of those wonderful things. And I'm going to tell you, Dr. Zina, the person that taught me how to pray is my mother. And we grew up in these demographics where, now watch this, then I truly believe this is the underlined and source for all of what's going on in our inner city mm-hmm. is we have a lot of untreated trauma in our poverty-stricken communities.
Yes, sir.
I grew up where they had in a project where you had breezeways. That's
mm-hmm.
that's New Orleans, and we was on the monkey balls, and I seen people brains blew out right before my eyes. Mm-hmm. I seen women raped. I seen people use drugs. I've seen all this firsthand. We was playing basketball. But all of this was being demonstrated and carried out right in front of us. And so I had this sense of trauma.
Mm.
I couldn't live in a country town because it was too quiet.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
I needed to hear ambulance and mm-hmm. police sirens mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. guns and people fighting. Mm-hmm. You know, if it happened now, it's probably like, oh, okay. You know, it was a trauma. And so
normal.
It becomes
mm-hmm.
my norm.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't a trigger. It was just my psychological norm.
Mm-hmm.
And so... my mother don't even know this, that in my search for that relief, that's when I found God. But I found God through my mother's posture of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
This is not ironic
mm-hmm.
that every morning at 7 a.m., I can walk out of our bedroom into that living room and my mother would be on her knees praying.
Hallelujah.
I don't care what was going on. Yeah. She would be on her knees praying. Mm-hmm. And I used to always just sit. I used to sit mm-hmm. on the floor in the corner and just watch her pray. And when she got up, she's like, boy, I didn't know you was dead. You know? And so that helped me through life.
Oh, yeah. I call it prayers on layaway.
Glory that's good.
Because,
that's
you know, she's laid those prayers
she
away.
Did.
And that's
she
why,
absolutely
you know,
did.
God has done what he's doing in
she
your
did.
Life now. And divine covering and protection. Yeah. And, you know, we've got to get beyond the now I lay me down to sleep.
Yeah.
Because the enemy doesn't care about your little penny and pamper wearing prayers.
Nah.
But the devil seeks to kill and destroy.
Yes,
and
he
so
does.
We
yes,
have
he does.
To know and understand how to strategically pray. Glory to God.
Yeah.
And I see it coming back in the church.
Ooh, Lord.
And I pray that it comes back even more because it's so needed. You see so many leaders under attack. And when you see a leader under attack, they clearly have a weak intercessory team or none at all.
At all. Right. That's absolutely true. I tell people all the time, you know, if you want to sit on the front pew, you have to be willing to stand on the front line.
Oh, that's it.
Be able to take those arrows, those hits, those bullets that's coming, because Satan take headshots, which is very vital to where we are now. I truly believe, Dr. Zina, that Satan has intensified his attack because, watch this, he see the division in our churches.
Mm-hmm. You're on it.
He mm-hmm. see that division.
Mm-hmm.
It's plain now.
Mm-hmm.
And so he have intensified that attack. We talk about millennials every day, and we talk about how they want explanation without engagement, and how they're in a position now where they want us to explain. They're smarter now, very intelligent.
Yeah.
But they don't even want nothing to do with the church. And that's a shame on the church, because we are so divided.
Yes. Yes.
That Satan is having a field day.
Oh, yeah. And, you
but
know, we're not as divided as we are disconnected.
That's it. That's
you know?
It. That's it.
It's a matter of creating doors and opportunities to be inclusive. You know, Archbishop Owens and co-pastor Susie Owens was on my show,
mm-hmm.
and they talked about the importance collaboration with the various communities, and that's in communities within your church. Because if you don't have that fixed on the inside, you can't fix what's on the outside.
Absolutely not. And it's vital that we understand that we are there to meet the needs.
Yes, yes.
We are absolutely there. That's it, to meet the needs of the people of God. You know, let's just continue to talk about this prayer piece. My mother's a walking miracle.
Amen.
Three strokes, two heart attacks, four passes on her heart.
Mm.
Oh, she's a walking miracle.
Praise
and
God.
So every time I see her, I say, thank you. Hey, good morning, miracle. You know, because I understand what prayer does.
Yes.
And even now in our society, it's our job to continue to pray, but also plan and have a strategy to help our generation today.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm
well,
excited.
You know,
I'm excited.
I'm telling you, I'm excited about what the Lord is doing, because voices like yours need to be heard more often.
Mm-hmm.
And we thank God for Kevin Adele and the Word Network for providing this opportunity.
Thank you so very much. Yeah.
I want you to look at that camera and begin to minister to some young brother, some young sister who feels like, you know what, I came from the hood, you know, and they say nothing good comes from the hood,
but
the devil is a liar.
The devil is a liar.
God is able and
he
is willing.
Yes,
he's
he
willing.
Is.
But it's a permissive will. You've got to open up and allow the Holy Ghost to come in, invite him in.
That's
and
right.
when you do, something begins to happen.
That's true.
There's a shift. And there's a shift in the land. You know, I talked the other day about the importance of speaking to the storm.
You
got to talk to it.
That's
you know, the devil talks back to us all
you
the time.
Talk back to
you
got to
talk back to the devil and tell him, you're a liar.
That's right.
Greater is he that is in me
That's
than
it.
He that
That's
is
it.
In the world.
That's it.
I am more than a conqueror
That's
in Christ
it.
Jesus. You've got to take that scripture
command it.
And
yeah.
prophetically pray and command and demand, by not by your own authority, but by the power of the Holy Ghost
That's
and the
it.
Blood of Jesus Christ. And the Lord will move.
Yes, he will. Absolutely so. Listen, I want to take this time to say that, you know, in this life today, you have a lot of frustrated individuals, depressed, bitter, individuals who don't understand life. Every morning that I wake up, I pray for three things. I ask the Lord for the what, the when, and the how.
Yes.
Coming up in our environment in which I grew up in the city of New Orleans, Louisiana, it was hard to find different examples to follow. And I had to find my peace, my joy, my happiness in the Lord Jesus Christ. And in coming up in those environments where you don't have all of the tools and all of the necessary platforms to put you where the Lord wants you to be, I had to trust in God.
Yeah.
The Lord has taken us all over this country in great places, all because I decided at 12 years old, when the Lord called me to preach, people laughed at me. People thought I was crazy. They say, well, he don't have nothing else to do. I had great friends who was in the NBA and NFL, but I decided to go a different route. I decided to trust God. When I decided to allow the Lord to come into my life at 12 years old, 20 years now, been preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Lord has done great things. And it's all because I didn't just hear the word of God, but I heeded to the word of God and allowed him to fill me up, to lead me and guide me. If I wouldn't take nothing for my journey. That's what the old folks used to say. He brought me too far to leave me.
Yes.
But I truly believe even now that wherever you are, that if you allow the Spirit of the Lord to come into your life right now, he would take you places that you never even dreamed of. People have to help you to pronounce it. I believe God will fulfill your every desire.
Yes.
Listen. You're not listening to somebody who grew up with a silver spoon in my mouth. Matter of fact, my entire life, if it had not been for the Lord, I can say that now, on my side, there's no way I'd be where I am today. To do what we do on a weekly basis, two churches and all of that great stuff, it have to be God. But I pray that the Lord touch you right where you are and give you your heart's desire and allow you to see things that you've never seen before and take you places you've never been before. Listen, I know he can do it. Listen, the old preacher used to say, I know he's all right.
Yes.
I know he's all right.
Yes,
I do. I know he's all right. Why, Pastor, I tried them for myself, and I believe God can do the same thing for you. He's not a respecter of person. God is a respecter of faith. If you can believe that he can do it, he can do exceedingly abundantly all that you even ask or even think. The Lord can perform it for you today.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, he can.
Hallelujah.
Yes, he can.
If he did it for David.
Yeah. If he did it for David.
All the trials and
Joseph,
tribulations.
Joseph. Oh,
God.
We can testify about the goodness
Jehoshaphat.
Of the Lord. Jehoshaphat. I mean, he done it so many times.
Yes.
You know, one of the things that's fascinating about David when he was traveling with the Ark of the Covenant, the first time he had his plans. And I think this is crucial to all of us.
Yes.
He had his own plans until the Lord interrupt his plan.
Yes.
And then he had to go back in prayer and ask the Lord, now show me how you want me to carry it.
He was wise enough
was
to
wise.
Do so.
Because
God will bring a divine interruption
yes,
in your
ma'am,
life.
Yes, ma'am, he will. Yes, ma'am,
when
he
you
will.
Make your own plans and do things the way you see them, God will divinely interrupt your
He'll
plans.
He'll humble you real
oh,
fast.
Glory to God. And so I have learned, beloved, to be content, as Paul said, in whatever state I'm in. And some of you may be going through something right now, and you're saying to yourself, you know what? That's all great what they're saying, but I'm still struggling. That's all great what they believe, but I'm still going through. That's all great what they've been through, but I'm still stuck in that same place. And you know what? That's a good place to be.
Great place.
Let me tell you why. Because when you open up your mouth and you begin from the fruit of your lips to God's ears, begin to ask him to help you, to save you, to move whatever mountain is in your way, anything that you are struggling with, that is contending with you, God will contend with it. All you've got to do is call on his name. I'm reminded of Jehoshaphat.
Yeah.
He had the haters, the enemies that were coming. He was trying to make friends with them. And
That's
they were
right.
like, well, no.
Mm-hmm.
And there are times when we want to be friends where God has not called us.
That's true. I tell people all the time, if they don't know you personally, don't take nothing they say personally.
That's it right there.
If they don't know you personally, whatever they say, don't take it personal, because that's going to happen. Haters, enemies, naysayers, they said I wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
But I'm a living witness and a testament that the Lord can do exceedingly abundantly all that we ask or even we think. Listen, she didn't ask me to do this, but listen, I just feel a heart sincerely, and I am a sore The Bible says he gives seed to the sowers. And I want to take this opportunity to say, listen, people of God, if you're listening right where you are, and this broadcast week in and week out been blessing your life, go to www.thebreakingroom.com. And I believe the Lord will help you and give you what you need to sow into this ministry. She didn't ask me. I don't even raise offering wherever I go. But I believe in being a blessing to somebody else. And I believe that God only gives seed to the sowers, and that the Lord would not give it to you if he can't get it through you. Go right now to www.thebreakingroom.com and sow the seed now. I believe that.
Praise God.
I believe that.
Bless
I believe
you,
in
man
doing
of God.
It. Yeah, I believe in doing
bless
it.
Bless you. Thank you so much.
Yes,
I
ma'am.
Just want to say this really quickly, and then I want you to close out in prayer.
I will.
For a minute. But how can people find you?
Oh, Lord. All our social media platforms, Instagram is Pastor JEO3. I wish I had time to explain that. Twitter is Pastor JEO3. And Facebook is just Jonathan Everett. That 03, when I was first started preaching at 12 years old, January the 3rd, 2003, my pastor mentor was shot and killed in front of his house.
Oh, Jesus.
As a young preacher, I didn't understand that. I didn't understand that. I wrestled with that for years.
Mm-hmm.
And so every year, January the 3rd, I always pray to God and say, God, I pray that my former pastor is pleased with what I'm doing.
Well, he
and
certainly
that,
is.
That gives me that energy.
You're
yeah,
sitting here
yeah.
with 90 million viewers
wow.
in 200 countries.
Wow,
so,
wow.
God is well
yeah,
pleased.
Yeah.
And
I'm excited,
so yeah. for those of you who desire to continue to connect for prayer, again, you can go to www.thebreakingroom.com. If you want to join us for our 7 a.m. call, the number is 1-712-451-0281, and the access code is 749-779-pound. I want you, man of God, to yeah. close out in prayer as we have about 1 minute left in this segment. Thank God for mm-hmm. your life
yeah.
and
yeah.
all that the Lord is doing in your life for mm-hmm. you and First Lady. And so I pray that every single thing you set your hands to do, that God would just bless it abundantly.
I receive. Once again, thank you so very
my
much.
My honor. Will not be your last if you desire to come
thank
back.
Thank you so anytime. I'm honored to have my wife here with me. And, of course, we give honor to Bishop Glenn A. Staples.
Yes.
To my pastor, Dr. Lawrence Sincere in New Orleans. But let me see if I can pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your abundance of joy.
Yes, Lord.
And even now, God, for those individuals who are watching us, who are in a state of shock, frustration, depression, they are bitter, confused, don't understand what tomorrow holds for them. Lord, I pray that you whisper into their ears that their next is better than their now.
Mm.
God, give them a spirit of release, oh God, that they can allow you to come into their life and take full control. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh upon mm-hmm. them right now, wherever they are, whether they're watching by cable or whether they're viewing it by web, whether they're viewing it by the app, I pray, God, that you touch them now. We thank you and we give you praise, for you declared that the steps of a good man or woman is already ordered by you. That God, Father, they can walk into the unknown knowing that you hold them in the palm
yes.
of your hand. We speak blessings upon their life. And God, Father, we thank you for all that has been done. It's in the awesome, most prophetic, profound name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen. Dr. Jonathan Everett,
Doc.
We thank God for you,
yeah.
even if it's not that yet, it's coming.
That's
amen.
It, that's it.
And so God bless you all. We'll see you next week, same time, same place at 5:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time here on the Word Network.